Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for joining this webinar. Neoplasms of the appendix is not a very common topic, but every day in and day out, we do a lot of appendicectomies. And sometimes it comes as a surprise that there is a tumor in the appendix. And many times we start wondering what next to be done. So if you do about 100 appendicectomies, about 1% of them may contain some tumor. Some of them may require resurgery or some other treatment. So it is best to understand this topic much better and also to update our knowledge. We have Dr. Noss, who is the consultant, general and laparoscopic surgeon from Hospet. She will enlighten us on neoplasms of appendix. Over to you, Dr. Noss.
Good evening, everyone. And I thank Dr. Shivram, sir, for this wonderful opportunity. And I thank you all for being present here today for this presentation. Neoplasms in the appendix is a very vast topic. And this has not actually got the importance it should be getting so far. There is a lot of confusion regarding the treatment of this particular disease. And the protocols are still evolving. So we still have, I have to do a lot of, unlearning before I actually prepared this presentation. It took a lot of reading, and there have been so many different types of treatment for this particular condition. And if there are anything to be added, and or if there is any corrections to be made, you are all welcome. So the appendicular neoplasms could be primary or secondary neoplasms. They are uncommon tumors of the gastrointestinal tract. And the incidence is usually about 0.9 to 1.5 per 1 lakh population per year. And it is said that about 1% of the appendicectomy specimens usually could have an appendicular neoplasm. They may be incidentally detected on histopathological examinations, and they may cause appendicitis. Benign are usually incidentally detected. Sometimes they may form a mass, and they may be detected during investigations. Sometimes during a colonoscopy for routine surveillance, an abnormal appendiceal orifice may be seen, and that should be investigated to pick up the lesion early. And when localized and detected early, generally it has a good prognosis. Now coming to the history, the first reference to carcinoma of the appendix was a case reported by Merling in 1838. In 1903, Elting reported a review and case series from 1838 to 1903. And out of which 43 cases, 23 were true carcinomas of the appendix. Earlier, what we used to think that pseudomyxoma peritonei was due to ovarian mucinous neoplasms, recent immunohistochemical, molecular, and genetic evidence has shown that these are appendiceal neoplasms. A little about the anatomy. Appendix is derived from the midgut and usually about 9 centimeters, and a maximum diameter is less than 6 millimeters. It has a variable position and arterial supply. We know that it is the appendicular artery and the accessory appendicular artery, and the venous drainage is the ileocolic veins, and the lymphatic drainage is the ileocolic nodes. The layers mimic GI tract, and it has a very limited elasticity. The horizontal orientation of the smooth muscle lack mucosal folds. And daily secretion is about 3 to 4 ml, and the lumen capacity is only 1 ml. And because it has a very poor peristaltic activity, in fact, very, very minimal, a high volume causes a limited compliance and predisposes to obstruction and inflammation. The histological composition helps us to understand the types of appendiceal neoplasms. We have the enterocyte giving rise to mucinous and non-mucinous epithelial cell neoplasms. Enterochromaffin cells give rise to neuroendocrine tumors. lymphoid tissue giving the lymphoma, and the goblet cell, which is only situated in the appendix, gives rise to the goblet cell tumor. Anything to be said now, or should I continue, sir?
Any questions anybody has? Nothing in the chart box. I think you continue, Dr. Noss.
Coming to the classification, we have epithelial neuroendocrine tumors and others. Neuroendocrine tumors are the commonest and comprise about 65% of the tumors. The appendicular neuroendocrine tumors are also called as a carcinoid tumor. Epithelial tumors, we have adenoma, mucinous neoplasms, and the colonic type adenocarcinoma. Of these, comprise about 20%. And among the mucinous neoplasms, we have low grade and high grade, that is LAMN and high grade mucinous neoplasms, and the mucinous adenocarcinoma. And the goblet cell carcinoma is actually, sometimes it is put under the neuroendocrine tumors, because it has both carcinoid features as well as the adenocarcinoma variety. And it's also called as a goblet cell carcinoid. And depending upon the presence of adenocarcinoma, it becomes more virulent and more malignant. Now, the other neoplasms we have are lymphomas, which is primary and secondary. There could be metastasis from various organs. Mesenchymal tumors, that is GIST, desmoid, leiomyoma, and leiomyosarcoma. And sarcomas, especially the HIV-associated Kaposi sarcoma, desmoplastic tumor, small round cell tumor, neuroectodermal and nerve sheath tumors, that is schwannoma and neurofibromas. Now, coming to the incidence and demographics, there is an increased incidence and decrease in age of presentation, probably because of better diagnosing modalities nowadays. Adenocarcinomas are seen in older patients between the 5th to 7th decade. Epithelial adenocarcinoma is the commonest malignant tumor, and that comprises about 60%, of which 37% are mucinous and 27% are non-mucinous. Neuroendocrine tumors are seen in younger patients, mostly in females around 40 years of age, and they could be both benign as well as malignant. And benign is the most commonest. Now, coming to the presentation, most of them present with acute appendicitis, that is about 30 to 50%, especially the neuroendocrine tumors. Abdominal pain may be a feature. Some of them present with a palpable mass. There could be GI or GU obstruction, urinary obstruction, or there could be even GI bleeding. Some of the patients will have abdominal distension, especially those with pseudomyxoma peritonei, and this is also called as the jelly belly. Then some of them have a carcinoid syndrome, and usually less than 10% of the neuroendocrine tumors. And when there is a carcinoid seen in appendicular neoplasm, it is usually seen with liver metastasis or when there are extensive retroperitoneal nodes, because those biopeptides are metabolized by the liver and through the portal circulation, and hence the carcinoid syndrome occurs only very late in the patients who present with the liver metastasis and retroperitoneal lymph nodes. Some of them present with appendicular torsion, and this presents again as appendicitis. And mucin within the hernia sac is also a type of presentation, and sometimes it gives us a surprise on the table.
Okay, Dr. Noss. So, if a patient presents as acute appendicitis,
yes,
is there anything we have to suspect there may be a tumor in this patient?
So the first investigation we do is usually an ultrasound. And if there is an ultrasound, if there is a solid looking lesion somewhere, and the patient has presented with an obstructive lesion, but you don't find a fecalith, in those patients you may suspect a malignancy, suspect appendicular neoplasms. And in elderly patients, we have to also keep in mind that this patient could be having some kind of a lesion, appendicular neoplasm.
Right, right. I think that is thing. Also, sometimes you have ultrasound report of appendicitis, enlarged appendix and all, but total count may not have raised.
Yes, sir.
So that's also another point.
Yes.
Anything else? Anybody wants to ask questions?
Madam, whether the size of the appendix on ultrasound will draw suspicion?
I'll come to that ultrasound later, but generally it is said that appendix more than 15 millimeters, we have to suspect a malignant, a neoplasm.
Yeah, yeah. Because I've seen a couple of cases where very large and very thick sizes, but no ficolith, no growth solid, only mucin inside.
Yes, yes. Then also, so the size criteria is very important. That more than 15 millimeters, we have to suspect.
We have to suspect. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yes. Shall I move further, sir?
Sure.
Coming to the investigations, ultrasound is the first pass, and usually it is done for appendicitis. And then there could be secondary signs of malignancy, like you can see a collection in the right iliac fossa, and then there is calcified foci in that. So that may be suggesting a malignancy. There could be, I'll give you the other features of different neoplasms as we go into the different sections. Then the CT also could give a diagnosis of a primary tumor and metastasis and help in staging. MRI is very useful, especially it should include diffusion-weighted imaging, dynamic contrast enhanced imaging, and water-soluble dye with oral contrast and antiperistaltic agents improve imaging when we are doing MRI. PET CT with 18F FDG helps in neuroendocrine tumors and in lymphoma, but because in mucinous neoplasms, they're usually posicellular, PET CT is not very useful. And coming to colonoscopy, it is a part of the investigation in these patients, in patients with appendicular neoplasms. It has 11% sensitivity, and it is also recommended to rule out synchronous colonic cancer and neuroendocrine tumors. And the other investigations we do are CA-19-9, CA-125, CEA, 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid, 5-HT and CGA. These last three are for carcinoid tumors. And of course, immunohistochemistry to identify the particular type of tumor.
Dr. Nawaz?
Yes, sir.
The Dr. Rajan says appendicitis in all elders, one should rule out right colon tumors.
Yes, sir.
As these are more common than appendicular tumors.
Yes, sir.
That's a valid point in older people, I think.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Veena has raised hand. Anything? Okay. Yeah. Yes, Dr. Veena, you can unmute and speak.
No, sir. Just present. I'm present. I'm telling. No, sir.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Are there any specific features of carcinoid in ultrasound, CT or MRI?
I'll come to those coming, sir.
Okay, sir.
I'll be dealing with each tumors and I'll just come to that.
Madam. Okay, thank you.
Epithelial tumor. Come for each of these tumors. Epithelial tumors are seen in about 0.2 to 0.3% of the appendicectomy specimens, and they're usually seen in the 5th to 7th decades. Detected often by imaging and usually present with mass and a higher complication rate. And these are classified as mucinous, non-mucinous and goblet cell carcinoma. So that is the picture of a mucinous neoplasm. And most of them, these comprise about 60% of the epithelial tumors. That is among the epithelial tumors, mucinous neoplasms are very common. They have a unique biology and they defy conventional definitions. They are posicellular, histologically inert, and yet they lead to a peritoneal dissemination and leading to pseudomyxoma peritonei. The spread is expansile, and that is, it means it is not infiltrative, and it is usually localized within the peritoneal cavity. A mucosal is a classic feature, and extra appendiceal spread of mucin, that is periappendiceal, and it could even lead to generalized, that is pseudomyxoma peritonei. Whenever there is an extra periappendiceal mucin or a ruptured mucosal, it does not always mean that it is a malignant lesion. It all depends upon the size. Anything beyond 6 centimeters could be malignant. So just the presence of a mucosal should not make us do an extensive right hemicolectomy for certain reasons, especially because we do not want the spread of mucin into the retroperitoneal tissues and behind the vena cava if you do a right hemicolectomy. So we should be a little careful while choosing surgery, especially in a mucinous neoplasm. Extraperitoneal dissemination is sometimes very uncommon, but sometimes seen. And usually these are classified as adenoma, low grade appendiceal mucinous neoplasms, high grade, and then pseudo maxima peritonei. That is especially seen with mucinous adenocarcinoma. Then we commonly come across a term called as mucoseal of the appendix. So this is just a descriptive term. It means a dilatation of the appendix with accumulation of mucin. And this is most often caused by epithelial proliferation, which could be both benign as well as malignant. It is less often seen sometimes with a fecalith obstruction and following inflammation. So we classify this into four types, that is mucus retention cysts, they usually are seen up to 1 centimeters. Mucosal hyperplasia, like colonic hyperplastic polyp, mucinous cyst adenoma, and the mucinous adenocarcinoma. These have to be differentiated from a Meckel's diverticulum, enteric duplication cyst, mesenteric cyst in women from a hydrosalpinx, ovarian cyst, and a tubo-ovarian abscess. A variant called the myxoglobulosis has multiple small round globules which produce 1 to 10 millimeter mobile calcifications. And sometimes we have what is called as a giant mucoseal, which you can see in the picture, wherein it is filling the entire peritoneal cavity. Then in patients with mucoseal, a colonic surveillance is needed because the CA colon risk is almost 6 times high in these patients. Pseudomyxoma peritonei. This is a syndrome characterized by presence of mucin and or epithelial cells within the peritoneum and on the serosa of abdominal organs. Usually the primary is appendix. Earlier we used to think it used to arise from the ovary, but now it has been proved that it is from the primary is usually the appendix. It is also seen with ovary, colon, pancreas, and from the urethras. Usually the mesentery and bowel are spared initially. Because of the peristaltic movements, these cells which are mobile do not appear to rest on the bowel. Hence, the bowel and mesentery are initially spared. And it usually grows within the peritoneum. And the hollow viscera are displaced and solid organs seem eroded. And that is what we call as a scalloped appearance. Yes, sir?
Oh, continue, Dr. Maas.
Calcifications may be seen sometimes. Sometimes they may cause intestinal obstruction, ureteric obstruction, and even biliary obstruction, vena cava obstructions. And based on the number and morphology of the cells, they have been divided into acellular, low or high grade, and then high grade with signet cells. The high grade with signet cells have the worst prognosis. And the treatment of this is cytoreductive surgery and HIPEC, that is hyperthermic intraperitoneal chemotherapy. And this is done on the peritoneal cancer index, which is between 1 to 39 by the CT or MRI. So now I come to the diagnosis. And usually it is diagnosed when the diameter exceeds more than 15 millimeters. We should suspect an appendicular neoplasm. Plain X-ray shows a right lower quadrant mass with peripheral calcifications. A contrast enema may show a cecum pushed laterally, and sometimes there may be a smooth indentation of the medial aspect. An ultrasound and other features I'll be coming one by one. PET CT is not a very useful diagnosis in these patients because it is posticellular. Colonoscopy has to be done. I'll come back again. And the tumor markers CA99, CA, and CA125. Now coming to ultrasound. Usually it shows an ovoid cystic pear-shaped mass, and also it is also called the chicken drumstick appearance. There are internal concentric layers, and this shows appears like an onion skin. Mural calcifications are seen, and these appear as porcelain appearances. And acoustic shadowing due to dystrophic calcification is seen in nearly up to 50%. And ultrasound is important to demark the right ovary. and extra appendiceal mucin may be seen as a hypoechoic collection.
What is chicken drumstick appearance?
So the chicken drumstick, the way it distends, the appendix distends is called chicken, it is called as chicken drumstick. So if you look at one of the MRI pictures, it looks like that.
Right.
Just to remember, they give us some eatables names. So looking now, coming to the MRI and CT, there is a dilated fluid filled low attenuation material. And the mural nodularity and wall thickening, they suggest malignant mucosal or an adenocarcinoma. Otherwise, the shape, wall calcifications, attenuation of internal content, periappendiceal fat stranding, and intraperitoneal free fluid do not differentiate benign from malignant. Ureteric obstruction sometimes will be picked up. Intussusceptions and air fluid levels, especially if it is infected, may be seen. Mucin over solid organs give a scalloped appearance, especially if you look at the picture. I don't know if I can see. You can see my arrow pointer, sir?
Yes, we can see.
So, yes, sir, the pointer there shows that there is a scalloped appearance of the liver. And MRI shows a fluid-filled appendix and shows a different signal intensity. A colonoscopy is an important tool in the workup of an appendicular neoplasm. There is a synchronous lesions may be picked up, especially in adenocarcinoma, and an invasion to the base from the appendix is also picked up. There is a particular sign called as a volcano sign, which is shown on colonoscopy. There is soft erythematous mass which, with a central crater which protrudes into the cecum, and this is the appendicular ostium. And this increases and decreases according to the respiratory movement, giving it like an appearance of a volcano. So this is a volcano sign. Coming to the histological correlation and staging, the most important is coming to the staging system. The grade is incorporated in the TNM staging here, and the mucin in the right iliac fossa is taken as T4 and T4M1A. And if mucin is beyond this, it is considered as regional metastasis. Nodal involvement is usually seen as mucinous adenocarcinoma in 20 to 26% of the patients. And there is an important thing to note is about the peritoneal cancer index. That is important to stage the pseudomyxoma peritonei. And this pseudomyxoma peritonei could have an acellular mucin or a disseminated peritoneal adenomucinosis and peritoneal mucinous carcinoma. And PMCAS is signet cells, presence of signet cells, which suggests a very poor prognosis. This is the TNM staging. Yeah. And this one, that is what I have told just now. I'll skip this slide, sir. And here, this is the peritoneal cancer index, which is very important in pseudomyxoma peritonei. And this here, you divide the abdomen into 9 quadrants plus 4 sites on the proximal and distal small bowel and mesentery. 4 sites are taken. Totally, it incorporates 13. And based on this, you give a gross disease, no gross disease from 1 to 3 up to 5 centimeters. And then your total score would be 39. And if the PCI score is greater than 30 with a high grade histology and extensive small bowel involvement, then we have to, it means it is a bad disease and these patients may require a new adjuvant chemotherapy. And there are certain contraindications that are biliary obstruction, extensive upper abdominal disease involving the vena cava, metastatic liver parenchyma and retroperitoneal nodes. These will not respond to treatment that is cytoreductive surgery and HIPEC.
This is for all intraperitoneal tumors, isn't
tumors.
It?
Yes, sir. Sprint. Yeah. All, yes, sir. And for pseudomyxoma peritonei, because we are those tumors which will require a cytoreductive surgery and a HIPEC, sir. Surface epithelial malignancies. So now coming to the treatment of a mucosal.
Dr. Noss, shall we take one or two questions?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Great. Dr. Prajwal. patient presented with appendicitis, intraoperatively appendicular 7 into 8 centimeter mass fixed to the retroperitoneum, underwent limited resection and diversion ileostomy. So histopathology was lymphoid proliferation of appendix. IHC did give any specific diagnosis?
Yes.
Dose require any further investigation or procedure?
So these might be due to a lymphoma. It may be associated with a generalized lymphoma. So they need to be evaluated with a CT of the chest, abdomen, or a PET CT to look for these and then treat accordingly. If it is generalized, then and since there was a spread, they might require radiation and chemotherapy.
Right. Doesn't require further surgery as such.
No? No, sir. For a lymphoma, I think you have done a limited resection, and even if there is a nodal disease, it means it is a generalized disease, so it has to be treated accordingly, and then.
Right. All right, Dr. Prajwal, you have any comment? Dr. Prajwal.
No, sir. Thank you, sir.
Right. So, Dr. Rajan, sir, you have some comments?
I have put my comments in the chat box, and that they need to evaluate the markers properly. And if the markers are abnormal, then further scans and probable surgery also necessary. But if the markers are normal, I will just wait and follow up with scans.
Right, right.
Okay. If the deposits are on the small bowel, will you do N block resection, madam?
Yes. If it is a resectable lesion, even if there is a need for multiple resections, you have to do it. And if at all you're doing a with the HIPEC, if you're combining it with the HIPEC,
those deposits will infiltrate through the serous and mucosa, you're using muscular is also.
Yeah. See, if it is adenocarcinoma, that means.
No. Pseudomyxoma peritoneum, I'm telling.
Peritoneum, yeah. If it is malignant, then it starts depositing there on the local side.
No, does it infiltrate the muscular is also?
It does. Over time, it does. So once it is infiltrating, it even causes bowel obstruction, it causes shortening of the mesentery. If it, especially an aggressive disease, causes all this.
Then multiple segmental resections at the patient needs.
And if whenever you are doing a multiple resections of the bowel, they have to be done after the HIPEC. You resection you do, anastomosis has to be done after the HIPEC, and only gastroesophageal junction, because edema causes difficulty in anastomosis, that has to be completed, and then the rest of the anastomosis has to be done later.
Okay, thank you.
Right. I think we'll continue, Dr. Nas.
Yes. Okay. Now, coming to our treatment of a mucosal, if it is disease localized to the appendix, if the base is not dilated beyond 2 centimeters and there is a good margin, we can do an appendicectomy, including its mesentery, that is its lymphadenectomy. If the base is compromised, that is wider than 2 centimeters, and the lesion is seen in the cecum, then we go for a deflectomy. And if you have a frozen section facility, and if the report comes later, there is a histopathological confirmation that it is benign, then they need to be followed up. If it comes as malignant, we have to go for a right hemicolectomy. And then T4A, that is a lesion, there is a mucin in the right iliac fossa. You do a laparoscopy for evaluation of resection of the residual disease, and then you can proceed with the, if there is a disease, extensive disease in the abdominal cavity, then you have to go for a cytoreductive surgery and HIPEC along with the right hemicolectomy. Otherwise, if it is just limited, you can remove the mucin, do the study of the, do the cytology, and if it is acellular, you can just observe them. Or you can do a right quadrant, right lower quadrant peritonectomy along with the appendicectomy if the base is not involved, or if the base is involved, you have to go for at least a deflectomy. And for a T4B disease, that is localized extension of the disease, you have to go for the local surgery, evaluate and assess the whether the patient is fit for surgery, do a cytoreduction surgery, peritonectomy, and a HIPEC. And in women, we have to add a hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo oophorectomy. But if she has not completed her fertile, still she has to bear children, then we have to do a we have to do a regular surveillance of this particular patient. If you do not do a bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy. And quite often we see that we come across patients who have perforated appendix, perforated mucosal. So that time we have to assess in a different way. That is, if it is non-perforated, I have told you just now. Coming to the perforated, we have, if there is a negative cytology, negative margins of resection, negative appendiceal lymph nodes, then what surgery is needed is just appendectomy. And because it is perforated, you may consider HIPEC. And if you do not do a HIPEC, they can be regularly followed because there are no cells in the peritoneal, in the fluid. So that is one. Suppose it is perforated, there is a positive cytology, but the margins are negative and there are negative appendiceal lymph nodes. Still, appendicectomy would be enough with a cytoreductive surgery and a HIPEC. Some patients, if it is an aggressive lesion, then we go for an early post-operative intraperitoneal chemotherapy because by leaving some tubes inside. Otherwise, we can just do a CRS and HIPEC. As I mentioned already, a right hemicolectomy should be avoided whenever in a localized disease because peritoneum acts like a barrier for from spread of disease into the extraperitoneal space, and hence proper assessment is needed. Now coming to when it is perforated, there is a positive cytology, positive margins of resection, and there are no lymph nodes. There are no lymph nodes. Still do a. You can still go ahead and do a cecectomy, and if it is perforated with the lymph node positive margins, then a right hemicolectomy. So that is the in all these patients, whenever there is a positive cytology, everybody would require a cytoreductive surgery and a HIPEC. Anything, sir?
Any questions? Dr. Noz, many times these patients who come as perforated appendicitis, okay, you'll be taking them for an emergency surgery or so.
Yes.
And you see that there is tumor and which has ruptured, which has presented with acute appendicitis.
Yes.
So neither the patient is ready or surgeon is prepared. And how will you deal such cases?
Sir, actually, if we just close, we do not have any material for a biopsy and we cannot state the disease. At least if the base is free, do an appendicectomy and include the mesentery, and then it helps in staging of the disease, whether there are lymph nodes, whether the base is involved, grade the disease, and then go further. And then in the post-operative period, we have to, once the inflammation subsides, we can do a CT and evaluate further. Meanwhile, the histopathology also guides us as what we should be doing next.
Okay, so what you are telling is whatever emergency has to be done, that should be done.
Yes, sir.
And then warn the patient about possibility of tumor.
Yes, sir.
And then take it up for the next surgery if it is required. All right, any other questions or anybody has other alternative thoughts?
How many cases of malignance, appendicular malignancies you have seen so far, madam, in your practice?
I have seen about 3 patients so far, sir. One was carcinoid, and one patient had mucinous neoplasm, and one patient had probably a malignance at the base. And then when I took her up for surgery, there was a missing appendix. She came later with the malignancy.
Okay. For all appendicitis patient, you evaluate with CT, MRI, everything?
No. Whenever there is a suspicion, I do evaluate. Especially the
most of the time, we will come to know perioperatively. And preoperatively, it's very difficult to predict whether a patient has got malignancy and all. Most of the time, after opening abdomen only, we'll come to know whether it's a mucosal or this thing.
Yes,
in my 22 years of practice, I have seen 3 cases of the appendicitis with associated malignancies, mucosal and all. I treated them with right hemicolectomy and ileocolic anastomosis. Okay.
Right. The idea of this presentation is to make much more informed decisions and also the evidence-based medicine. So I think Dr. Noz has pointed out many things. I think we'll continue. Any other questions or comments?
Mucosal of the appendix perforated after appendixectomy. Can we put a drain?
If anybody could add a point, I'm not very sure.
The clinical picture Dr. Shivaram sir described.
Yes.
You may see such cases.
I think you should be avoiding drains in these patients.
If you suspect tumor and all, better not to put the drain.
Not to put a drain. Because if it is a mucinous neoplasm, you would be causing an extra peritoneal spread, which otherwise wouldn't have occurred. So especially in a mucinous neoplasm, avoid putting a drain.
Thank you.
Yes.
Also expose, opening the retroperitoneal space. It's a very good point, as told. If you are suspecting pseudomyxoma peritonei, don't open up the extraperitoneal tissues.
Yes.
Or do as limited as possible.
Yes, initially do as limited. And assess and then go further.
Yeah.
Because you cannot come back. At least you can go further if you have done a limited work.
Calcification of the appendix is another very important point which can be picked up even with X-ray or CT scan. Recently, we had one patient calcification in the appendix. It turned out to be malignant.
Yes, especially in a carcinoid.
True. Mm-hmm.
Now, coming to a non-mucinous type, this is usually the colonic type. And they comprise about 30% of the epithelial neoplasms and seen around in the sixth decade. Appendicitis secondary to luminal obstruction can occur. There could be a polyp, adenoma, or a carcinoma. And on imaging, a soft tissue mass, adjacent organs may be involved. Fat stranding may be present. Lymph node enlargement and a metastatic disease is to be picked up. Now for a colonic type, the treatment, staging and treatment is like the colonic type. In a T1, which is low grade, a simple appendicectomy would be enough. It is considered like a polyp. But if it is a T1 and beyond, and if it is a high grade T1 reaching the base with angiolymphatic invasion and T2 and above, they have to be evaluated with CT and or MRI and then proceeded for right hemicolectomy. And in females, oophorectomy is to be done in poorly differentiated tumors. And peritoneal disease will require a cytoreductive surgery and a HIPEC. If it is node positive and distant metastasis, systemic chemotherapy with the 5-fluorouracil, that is FOLFOX regime, same as for CA colon. And for liver and lung, if they are operable, we can do a metastatectomy in selected patients. And a colonoscopy is a must in all these patients to rule out the synchronous malignancies and as a surveillance in future. Anything, sir, regarding this?
Yeah. Dr. Rajan has made a comment. I have had only one. I came to know that I had missed the tumor because the patient came back to me with mucus discharge through the wound.
Yes,
sir. Mucus reoperated with right hemicolectomy and he did well. I think this is a very important message that many times we do appendicectomy, but forget to see the biopsy report. Yes. So when the patient comes back, it's very, very important to follow up with the patient and see the histopathology report. Earlier, some people never used to send the appendix for biopsy. I think now that practice is not there. Everybody will do histopathological examination. It's very important for us to go back and see the biopsy report. Right, Dr. Nas, that is a very important look into the biopsy. Dr. Rajan, sir?
Yes, yes. That was exactly what happened. Those days we were not sending the every appendix for biopsy and apparently we missed it. It is now regular practice to send all removed specimens at surgery for histopathology and make sure that you read and see the biopsy report yourself. Don't rely on secondhand people seeing the report and then telling you. There are many slips that happen. You have to personally look at reports to make sure you're not missing these things.
Thank you, sir. Now,
okay, Dr. Noss, continue.
Coming to the goblet cell tumors, they are also called as goblet cell carcinoid. These tumors are exclusively seen only in the appendix. The male-female ratio is equal and usually about 15, and the age group is about 59 years, median age. Appendicitis is a common presentation. They could be infiltrative, especially if there is an adenocarcinoma, and there could be carcinoid elements and mucinous and non-mucinous. More elements of adenocarcinoma is a bad prognostic sign. And in these patients, peritoneal metastases are common. The CT is used for staging. And if there is a localized disease, the treatment would be right hemicolectomy, lymphadenectomy. And if it is node positive, then they would require chemotherapy. And for peritoneal mets, cytoreductive surgery and HIPEC. And these patients to be followed up with CA, CA125 and CA199. And these patients have a better prognosis than adenocarcinoma.
What is the difference between prognosis with cytoreductive surgery and without cytoreductive surgery?
If there is a peritoneal disease, it is better to do cytoreductive surgery.
No, I know better to do, what is the prognosis difference?
No, Dr. Srikanth, it is like this. If it is pseudomyxoma peritonei and you have done a appendicectomy and whatever resection is required and it is spread all over the peritoneal cavity, you do a good cytoreduction surgery and also HIPEC, there is a very good chance of patient getting cured also if it is low-grade malignancy. So that way, I think this has revolutionized the management of pseudomyxoma peritonei with the cytoreductive surgery with HIPEC. Agreed, Dr. Noss?
Yes, sir.
So also the peritoneal carcinomatosis index is important. See, certain patients we may not be taken up for this curative intent of treatment if there is extensive disease. Right.
Now coming to the neuroendocrine tumors, we have both carcinoid as well as non-carcinoid. In appendix, the carcinoid is the most commonest. The non-carcinoid are paraganglioma, pheochromocytoma, and the ganglioneuroma. It is the commonest tumor of the appendix and presents as appendicitis. It is said that about 0.3 to 0.9% of the appendicectomy specimens could have a carcinoid. And most of the time it comes as a histological surprise because there's usually less than 1 centimeter and mostly located at the tip. Those at the base can cause appendicitis by causing obstruction. And common in women around the fourth decade. They're also seen in pediatric group and younger patients, and sometimes they can cause an acute abdomen. They're mostly benign, and regional adenopathy and hepatic metastasis are very rare, and carcinoid syndrome, as I told earlier, is seen especially when there is metastasis in the liver and extensive retroperitoneal lymph node involvement. And they are usually hot flushes, diarrhea, wheeze, and they could have palpitations, tachycardia. The diagnosis is for the small lesions are usually difficult to pick up. Sometimes on an ultrasound, they can be picked up as a small nodule at the tip. And they have calcifications and it can be picked up on an X-ray, but most of the time they are mistaken as picolets. The regional lymph nodes are involved in less than 10% of the patients, as so also the distant metastasis. Many a times they can form soft tissue masses, especially like the small bowel carcinoids, that is, and produce an irregular desmoplastic reaction with calcification. This is another feature of carcinoids. They can be detected from as carcinoids by the serum CGA levels, 24-hour urine 5-hydroxyindoleacetic acid, that is CGA is chromogranin A, or fasting plasma high 5-HIAA. The 5-hydroxyindoleacetic acid levels usually vary in urine based on the diet, that is avocado and cheese, and they have to be very carefully evaluated, or they can give a false level, raised levels. And nowadays, platelet and urinary serotonin is also being done. And then to assess hypervascular beds, a triple phase CT or a contrast MRI is useful. Indium 111, triple one, penetriotide, that is also called as octreo scan, or a functional PET imaging with a 68 gallium dotatate. This is preferred in detecting carcinoids. Anything, sir?
Not, no questions. That is the Dotanac scan.
Yes,
no?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Right, right.
The
okay.
Based on the size of the tumor here, that is a tumor less than 2 centimeters in its greatest dimension is T1. And in that we have A and B, that is one and less than 1 and 1 to 2 centimeters. And then 2 is between 2 to 4, 3 more than 4, and 4 and T4 tumor penetrates or invades the adjacent organs. And then N0, N1 as usual. Now coming to the treatment and follow-up, usually lesions less than 1.5 centimeters are benign and they have no metastasis. And that too, those lesions which are formalin fixed, measured after formalin fixation, are lesion less than 1.5 centimeters. So these lesions, they are unlikely to have metastasis. Larger ones have metastasis to the liver as well as to the lymph nodes. And mostly discovered, the lesions are mostly discovered incidentally on HP after an appendicectomy. And suppose you have detected it after an appendicectomy, we can wait and watch after the histopathology, whether the vase is not involved and there are mesentery is also not involved and there are no lymph nodes, we can wait and watch. Meanwhile, if there are lymph nodes or if the lesion is near the base, they'll need to undergo a right hemicolectomy with lymphadenectomy, metastatic, and if there are metastasis, metastatectomy and surgical debulking is also advised, especially if the patient is having a carcinoid syndrome. Surgical debulking will help in reducing his symptoms of carcinoid syndrome. And these patients receive somatostatin as treatment, and hence they can be offered an elective cholecystectomy because these patients can present with cholelithiasis and cholecystitis. The treatment used are somatostatin analogs. We have long-acting somatostatin, which can be given as a monthly dose. And recently, 177 lutetium dotatate has been used as a therapeutic drug. Chemotherapy is being tried with everolimus and other chemotherapeutic agents. Chemoembolization and hepatic artery ligation also help in some patients with liver metastasis, especially with multiple liver mets. And for a carcinoid crisis, which occurs in patients with stress or during anesthesia, these patients during the start of chemotherapy, they can be managed with a somatostatin analog, and the newer drug available is what I've mentioned here, SMS201995. Just for a completion of this. Thus, this is just a flow chart. So to say that, make it easier. So if it is less than 2 centimeters and confined to the appendix, do an appendicectomy, and that would suffice. If it is less than 2 centimeters but located at the base, or there is an incomplete resection, or intermediate or high-grade tumors with lymphovascular invasion or mesoappendix invasion, they'll require right hemicolectomy. Similarly, anything beyond 2 centimeters with positive lymph nodes, positive margins, they'll need to undergo an imaging, biochemical evaluation, and a right hemicolectomy. And a metastatic disease require a multidisciplinary evaluation and treatment. Yes, sir.
Right. Now, Dr. Srikant is asking, what is the carcinoid crisis?
Yeah, the carcinoid crisis is a sudden patient presenting with severe hot flushes and severe tachycardia. The patient will have hypothermia, which is not responding to treatment. And these patients suddenly may go into shock, and even they may even land up with coma. So these patients usually, whenever there is a patient with carcinoid, and we are taking this patient for surgery, like in pheochromocytoma, we have to suspect that these could develop a carcinoid crisis, and they have to be treated accordingly. And somatostatin injection at this particular time as, comes as a boon, and these patients can be treated with the somatostatin injections. Especially during anesthesia and the start of chemotherapy, the stress, at least we cannot see these patients in front of us. But whenever we are treating these patients, these we can land up with a patient having a carcinoid crisis.
Right. Dr. Srikanth, is it due to increased
excess CGA?
Yes, yeah, all this, there are nearing 50 biopeptides. So these get released, 50 biopeptides which are released from the carcinoids. And there are so many kallikrein, so many 5-hydroxytryptamine, serotonin. See, all these can cause reactions. So they get released into the circulation and suddenly they can cause this feature.
Okay. Right. All right, yes. Carry on.
And sometimes the carcinoids, especially when there are metastasis or lung carcinoids, they can present with the right heart disease, especially that is the tricuspid valve and the pulmonary valve. Pulmonary valve is less common, but it is the tricuspid valve. They can cause problems with the tricuspid valve, fibrosis and regurgitations. Yes, sir.
No, okay, we'll continue.
Other tumors we discussed as lymphoma, sarcoma, and the mesenchymal tumors. GIST is very rare. So also the leiomyoma, desmoid, leiomyosarcoma, Nernst tumors, and the secondary involvement of the appendix, the colon and pelvic malignancies, and even the secondaries. So that is the secondaries which are seen in the appendix in this patient here. Now, lymphoma is the GI tract is the commonest extranodal site for a lymphoma. It can be seen in stomach, small intestine, pharynx, colon, and esophagus. About 0.15% of the appendicectomy specimens can show a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, that is a Burkitt's lymphoma, and it is more common in males and it is usually seen in children about 18 years of age. They may present with appendicitis, mass, and right atrial fossa pain. On imaging, there is an enlargement of the appendix, and most important here is that the vermiform shape of the appendix is maintained. And on ultrasound, they appear so hypoechoic, it appears like a cystic dilatation. So if it's a primary Burkitt's lymphoma and there is no disease elsewhere, and there is only just a diffuse wall thickening, enlargement of the lumen, aneurysmal dilatation, the treatment is just appendicectomy. If it is secondary, there is regional adenopathy, bowel involvement, and then treatment as for a lymphoma elsewhere. And the treatment is with the CHOP regime with rituximab for large B cell lymphomas. Anything, sir?
That's all. No questions as such. Anybody has any comment?
For primary lymphomas, no chemotherapy is required, is it?
For a Burkitt's lymphoma, if it is only there, nowhere else, you have to evaluate. If it is only in the appendix and nowhere else, maybe the treatment is appendicectomy. But if it is extensive, then you need need chemotherapy for these patients.
No, localized to appendix, I'm telling.
Yeah, localized to appendix is appendicectomy.
Appendicectomy. Yeah. Any oncosurgeons are there? Any comments? Dr. Girish? Right, I think we'll continue on, Dr. Noss.
Yes. And the prognosis for a carcinoid and the first chart is for the occurrence as well as the prognosis, the 5-year survival rate. For a carcinoid, it is the most common neoplasm, and the 5-year survival is as much as 80 to 85%. And so also for the lymphoma, very poor prognosis when it is a metastatic lesion and for mucinous neoplasms. For a villous adenoma or a benign mucinous neoplasm, the prognosis is much better. and the worst prognosis is for a malignant for a signet ring those neoplasms with the signet ring cells, and the best prognosis is for a malignant carcinoid compared to all the malignancies. And goblet cell carcinoid has a better prognosis than the mucinous and colonic adenocarcinomas. And thus, to conclude, appendiceal neoplasms, they are rare. Such a small organ giving rise to so many neoplasms is sometimes really surprising. They are encountered at some time during our practice, and hence we should be knowing which tumor, which lesion we have to treat and how. And elderly patients with acute appendicitis, we have to carefully have an insight into the cause. Generally, they are genetically and biologically different tumors, and they need a separate classification and separate treatment regimens. Early diagnosis has a good prognosis, and the signet cell lesions have the worst prognosis. Neuroendocrine tumors are the commonest, and adenocarcinoma is the commonest malignant. Those of low grade, those situated at the tip, less than 1 centimeter without lymphovascular invasion, appendicectomy alone is enough. For mucinous neoplasms, if ruptured or extending beyond serosa, they cause pseudomaxima peritonei and have to be treated with cytoreductive surgery and HIPEC. It gives very good results, and they have to be referred to a high volume center for an optimum result. And colonoscopy must be done to rule out synchronous malignancy in all the patients.
Thank you, Dr. Noss. Anybody has any questions, comments?
Yes, sir. Nothing has such power to broaden the mind as the ability to investigate systematically and truly all that comes under thy observation in life. I thought this was very appropriate for this presentation, sir. Thank you so much.
Very, very correct.
Thank you for opportunity, sir. Thank you, sir.
Srikant?
Congratulations, madam.
Thank you, sir.
I'm under NASC crisis now.
Thank you.
Fantastic. You two, yes, are dedicated. Fantastic. Excellent.
Thank you.
No words to describe.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Also, all questions she knows answers.
Yeah.
Carcinoid crisis.
Fantastic. Yes. Any subject, I think.
Thank you.
Thank nice you, Shuram, sir, for bringing her. And thank also Rajan, sir.
I didn't do anything.
No, you are the pivot, I think.
Yes.
Nice update on appendicular tumors, ma'am. It refreshed my memory a lot, and I am deeply grateful that I attended this session.
Yes, even though
there is a nice session of cricket going on at Lord's, but I said no.
Yes, sir.
I came for this. Okay. Well done. We look forward to more inspiring lectures from you in the future.
Thank you.
You guys have to take it on. Our days are over.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Girish has a comment. In case of any mucinous neoplasms, mucoceles sending peritoneal salvage is advisable always. True. Dr. Girish?
Yes.
Peritoneal lavage, is it? Okay. Dr. Girish, you want to make any comment? You have to unmute. Peritoneal lavage for cytology. Yeah. I think Dr. Naz, you made a wonderful presentation. It's a very common subject, appendicectomy. We keep on doing it, but sometimes get stuck, as I said, always. So there, what to do? This has given very clear direction for all of us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
So Dr. Naz actually volunteered to teach all of us, and also she said, if I am presenting, I'll be learning more. I think that's where we all have to learn from her. Thank you very much. Good night, everybody. Thank you.
Please put it on the YouTube, madam.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Sure, sir. We'll do it. So. Thank you.